Testing 1, 2, 3. Check, check. Check, check. Testing 1, 2, 3. Mic check. Check, check. Testing 1, 2, 3. Mic check. Testing 1. Check, check. Check, check, mic check, testing 1, 2, 3. Mic check, testing 1, 2, 3. Mic check, testing 1, 2, 3. Check, check. Check, testing 1, 2, 3, mic check. Mic check, testing 1, 2, 3, mic check. Check. Check, check, mic check, testing 1, 2, 3, mic check. Mic check, testing 1, 2, 3, mic check. Check, check, testing 1, 2, 3. Mic check, testing 1, 2, 3, mic check.
Mic check. 1, 2, 1, 2.
All right. 1, 2. Good afternoon, everybody. How's everybody doing? Y'all good? I am Joe Claire from the Joe Claire Morning Show on WPGC 95.5. How many of y'all listen? More hands supposed to go up than that. All y'all supposed to be like, yeah, we listen. All right, well, start listening. Turn your stations back to 95.5. I'm super, super duper excited to be here with you guys today to be your facilitator. I will be facilitating for the rest of the afternoon, and you all have an incredible, incredible afternoon in front of you. As you can see, people are rolling in. We have a lot of people from radio. We have my guy, Guy Lambert from WPGC. We have Tony Reds. From WPGC. Give it up for Tony Reds. I know y'all know Tony. This is Poet from the Joe Claire Morning Show as well. We have Flavor from WKYS in the building. We have Pedro from El Zol in the building. Pedro. Oh, this is Britt Waters from WKYS, ladies and gentlemen. And the Russ Paul Morning Show in the building. Give her some love. So, we are super excited to be here this afternoon, guys. This is an opportunity to have an open and honest discussion with the people who are committed to improving opportunities here in the district, all right? And when we're talking about people, we're talking about the mayor and her administration. We don't want today. We don't want bashful. We don't want shy. We don't want quiet. We don't want, oh, I'm chilling. We want to hear from you. We need to know what you need us to know. We need you to voice your opinion. The mayor told me she came to listen. Do you know how many cities the mayor's never listened to the young people? All of them. So you guys have a great opportunity today. You see all of these people buzzing around and stuff, because this is important. But it's only important if you voice your opinion, all right?
All right.
Y'all better stop playing, all right? Yeah. I ain't playing. We can't. This is serious. I said serious. This is a serious matter. So please, listen up, speak your mind, and make sure you are heard today, okay? Boy, y'all sure are quiet. Y'all nervous? It's hot? Yeah, y'all don't act like this when y'all around y'all way. Yeah, y'all don't know. See, I act like I'm around my way all the time. So you should too. You should make sure that you act like you act when you with your friends. Relax, chill out, and be heard today, all right? All right. We're going to let everybody finish setting up and getting settled. Look at this. I never seen this much commotion in my life. You know how lucky you people are? I have a mayor. It's hot. You know you can't get grown people to sit still while it's hot. This is wonderful. We ready? Okay, take your time. So I wanted to express to you once again, I am from the area, I am from the DMV. I'm not one of the people who came from somewhere else to do this here. I am born and raised here. I remember when they built this library. I remember when this library got built. I've done so many things inside Washington, D.C., and for those of you who don't know me, let me see, I worked for BET for a billion years. I used to host a show called Rap City on BET. Now, a lot of y'all remember Tigger used to host Rap City. I'm before Tigger. Then I hosted a show called Mad Sports on BET. I hosted Black College Football on BET. I did Comic View on BET. I did everything on BET. I used to be on the Russ Paul Morning Show when Russ Paul first came to D.C. I was on that show. I moved out to Los Angeles. I worked with all kinds of people. I interviewed people all over the place. And now I am back in Washington, D.C., just like you guys, to be the best, be the voice for the city and be the best morning show that I could be for you all. And thank you for for giving me that honor of being your voice. So without further ado, I've talked long enough. Ladies and gentlemen, she is here. Give it up for our mayor, Muriel Bowser. Make some noise. Come on. Y'all can do better than that. No, y'all can do better than that.
How are you?
Good to see you. No problem.
Hot.
Thanks for having me. Ain't it hot? This looks like the Today Show or something. We really doing it at MLK Library. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Joe. Good afternoon, young lady.
Let me take mine.
It's good to see everybody at our wonderful Martin Luther King Jr. Library, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Thanks for being here, Joe.
No problem. Thanks for having me. I'm committed like you are.
Yes. So we wanted to get everybody together to hear from our young people. Oftentimes in the government, we go down to City Hall or we go out to community meetings and we come up with programs and services, and we forget to ask the kids if there are programs and services that are going to work for them. So I know you, like me, were probably riveted to your TVs. You heard and you saw young people in the city of Baltimore saying what they needed, what was going on in their neighborhoods, what their interactions were like with the city, with their schools, with the police. And it's important for me. We're about 115 or so days into the Bowser administration. And it's real critical that I know up front what we're doing right, what we can do better, and we want to listen to you. So I worked with our new deputy mayor for greater economic opportunity, Courtney Snowden, to make sure we put together, give her a hand, she deserves it.
Yes.
And over the last week, Joe, we've just been all digital, talking about if you only knew this about me, Mayor Bowser, I think you might make this program work this way or make this change at my school. We've gotten a lot of response, if you knew. And so that's kind of the basis of our discussion today. We thought it was important that you come and moderate.
Thank you for having
me. Because you have a platform like no other.
True indeed.
And so you can amplify the discussion beyond today.
Yeah, because tomorrow morning, whatever happens here, I will be talking about on my show, the good and the bad. So get it all out.
Get it all out.
Get it all out. Come on.
So this is time for the adults to stop talking.
True indeed.
And the kids and the young people. And the other thing that, you know, sometimes we forget in government is we treat all our young people like they're exactly the same. So if they're in the second grade or the 12th grade, we have the exact same program. And what we are focused on in our administration is especially young people 18 to 24 years old, because that's where we know we have people, young people thinking about their futures and especially wanting to hear from adults how you got there. So when you started your introduction talking about your career, there may be somebody right here in this audience who wants to be like you. And it's so helpful for them to hear how you got there.
Oh, well, I'll tell you all day, any day. Come talk to me. I'll let you know how I got here. It's a beautiful life, too. I need you to know that. Yeah, it's a wonderful thing. Education is key. Like I told you, I remember when they built this because I had to come here each and every Saturday. My mother bought me in here. Well, that's how I'm getting off the subject.
Right.
But we do want to hear from you guys today. Everybody have a red and green paddle? You have. We'll be asking you a series of questions. Red means no, green means yes. So, you know, when asked, please make sure that you show your appropriate response. And I see hands are going up already. So if it's all right with you, let's go ahead and dive in. Tony, there's a brother behind you at the top of the bleachers who been trying to get my attention for a minute now.
Yeah, where you at?
Right here. This brother right here. No, you waved your hand. I thought you needed me for something.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
I got somebody over here.
Yes, let's do it. Hey, Molette.
Hi,
ladies
Molette.
And gentlemen,
hi,
let Molette Green.
You. Yes.
Yes, indeed.
Thank you.
I have some young people who say they have a voice and they want to be heard. I've been talking to them before this thing got started. And what do you want to say? First, tell us your name, your grade, your school.
My name is Tajay. I go to Anacostia Junior High School. I'm in the 10th grade. And I think
your, if yes, you'll put up your green. If no, you'll put up your red. Do you feel safe going back and forth to school? Okay, so a good number of you do. So we've worked real hard with the police department, with the schools, to work on those issues. But I know a lot of young people don't feel safe going back and forth to school. So we have put in place what we're calling our community response team. It's a rapid response team. So from time to time, we know that there are beefs between neighborhoods, right? Sometimes they show up at school. Sometimes they show up on the metro bus. Sometimes they show up on the train. And sometimes when one incident happens on Thursday, something else happens in response on Friday. So our rapid response team is not just police, because the police can't do it all. It includes DYRS. I see our new DYRS director here. It includes our human services department. And it includes our folks at DOES that are focused on after-school programs and training.
Now, I had a question. I saw that when the mayor asked if you felt safe going to school, you raised no. You put the red up. Can you elaborate? Please state your name. You know what school you go to, what grade you're in, and
job in this city and
all, I'm very happy to say that we are now trending number one on Twitter with our hashtag.
Yes.
So that's something
yes,
to celebrate.
Yes, yes, yes.
Can't say we're not making a difference. So our first Twitter question of today will be for the mayor. What is the best way to become active in our community?
Good question. Mm. So there's so many ways to be active in the community. Many of you have local recreation centers, and you can be active and be a volunteer and be a mentor, participate at the local recreation center. Many of you have, all of you have a local school that has a student in a community group that helps advise the school on how to run the school. Others of you can be involved in your church groups that have leadership opportunities there. We have leadership opportunities right in the city. You see Dion Burkett, who's behind you, and she helps run our Youth Advisory Council.
Yes.
And we have many others here who are part of our mayor's advisory council. And then when you turn 18, you can start to formally get involved. You could become an advisory neighborhood commissioner. You can become an officer in your civic association. Or you could just go to those meetings. And so those are a number of ways to get involved. But it sounds like we have a to-do item for the deputy mayor, that we will come up with a list of different leadership opportunities that young people can be engaged in. Now, I want to make sure that everybody, a lot of folks here would have already signed up for the Summer Youth Program. We want to keep you aware of other training opportunities. And the last thing I'll say about getting involved, once you finish high school, if you're trying to figure out what to do next, we also want to connect you to the University of the District of Columbia. Mm. You may not know, so I'll say, if you knew, do you know that there are workforce training opportunities at UDC for free at PR Harris? And we want to make sure we're connecting you to those opportunities.
Madam Mayor, in the news, we've been talking about Freddie Gray in Baltimore and the Black Lives Matter movement. I have a young man who has had an experience with police. Can you share a little bit about what has happened to you? This is Russell.
Hi, Russell.
How you doing? My name is Russell Gaskins. I work for High Hopes, War 7 and 8 Drug-Free Coalition Program.
Okay.
I'm a mentor, 23 years old. Basically, growing up, I'm from Washington, D.C., 6th Street Southeast. Growing up in a community and looking how I look, I basically fit the description. And it's a lot of police in the area that's not from my area, you know, and it's not the color of my skin, you know. So I tend to get stopped a lot, you know, for whoever knows, description or whatever. But, you know, going about my business, you know, doing what I'm doing, positive things, trying to help the youth, I get stopped and I get chastised for being, you know, a black man. And I feel that, you know, maybe we should have more police in the community that's from the community, you know, that actually know these guys, that can, you know, relate and, you know, coexist with these instead of, like, having, like, Europeans or even black males not even from the area, never even grew up, don't know no one. And, like, you can't really relate and, you know, you can't govern this area if you're not from this area. It's like, if you're a boxer, which I'm a boxer, you can't be a computer technician and try to tell me about boxing or try to govern me how to box, because you've never been through what I've been through and you've never trained like I trained. So you really are not
on mentorship. I'm glad you brought that up. I have mentored a number of young black males. When I got out of Morgan State University, I became a social worker. Oh, yes, indeed. Yes, I went to. Yes, indeed. I became a social worker before I got into entertainment. And my core, the thing I did most was make sure that I went and spoke to cats from the neighborhood, because we needed to help more. I saw that we needed to help more than anybody else, and we needed to understand how to navigate in this world we were trying to get into. Like you say, you get stopped for looking like you look. So when you try to go navigate, it's like a lot of roadblocks. But if you know how to say the right thing out your mouth, all the roadblocks are gone. I mean, to be quite honest, I had to, you know, put on the two languages. Yes, officer. Sure, officer. I'll be happy to, officer. No. And then as soon as he leaves, I'll be like, hey, man, where y'all going? It's just part of becoming who you want to become. It sounds a little funny, but it's real. Now, let's talk about entertainment. I've been in hip-hop music for 20-plus years. I've seen the influence it has. I've seen dudes come home from prison saying, and I'm like, how did you get there? And they like, tell you the truth, I was watching TV and trying to be like what was happening in the videos, and then I took it out in the street. Next thing you know, boom, I'm in here. I actually opened a letter one day on BET from a guy I grew up with, because we used to answer letters from prison on Rap City. I opened a letter, it's a guy that I grew up with. He's saying, how you doing to me? And I'm like, oh my God, I really know this guy. The thing is, I think that you really can't ask a government to do this. You have to do this for yourself. You have to learn where to draw the line, man. That's TV. You can't believe that. And if you, it's because the way I look at it, the rapper is standing next to the superhero cartoon. They both fake. You know what I'm saying? They both fake. Yeah, he can rap. And he might have seen a lot of that stuff that he's rapping about, but he didn't do it. If he did do it, and you see the ones who did it, they on their way to jail. So I'm gonna say this to the young people. Television is television. It is entertainment. Music is specifically entertainment of your mind, making you conjure up pictures on your own. Don't believe that. I'm telling you from my mouth, do not believe that.
Okay.
It's made up.
Joe, and just to elaborate, I'm right here. I'm sorry.
Tony Red,
yeah, Tony Red, 24/7.
Somebody
yeah.
Give that man a whistle.
No, yeah, I'm just sorry. Just match my colors. Match my sixes. I'm sorry.
Tony Red.
Okay, but like you said, you worked at you was a social worker when you came home. I worked at the Mayor's Youth Leadership Institute. I was a counselor.
Yes, indeed.
Counselor.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
That's right. I came up through that. And when I came through that program, we had mentors back then like the Jake Roaches and the Alexis Robesons, and we were able to intern at government facilities to see how people navigate and operate. So when we learned those things, when we came out into the community and we had those interactions with police, we knew how to govern ourselves. You got to understand, a negative reaction, it causes another reaction. And if you respond negatively to someone, then they automatically get on the defensive. So you matter if you say the right things and de-escalate the situation, you can kind of navigate your way out of that situation.
Did you just say de-escalate with that outfit on?
Absolutely.
I know that's right, bro.
Absolutely.
I know that's
I'm
right.
I'm a product of my environment. Thank you. Ward 4, Ward 6, Ward 8. We have a young man with a question right now.
How y'all doing out there? My name is Fella Soul, and I'm actually just came from Sacramento, California, and then Gulfport. Now I'm here in Washington, D.C., and I've been speaking to the youth a lot. And I'm actually a vocalist, an artist. And what happened is I was in the worst part of the city of Chicago. And I've been, you know, shot up, locked up and everything. But what I found out is this, piggybacking off of what my brother was saying. You know, God took me over. He taught me and gave me a new tongue. And that's what changed my life. You know, I found out, and it says in James chapter 3, verse 2, for in many things we offend all, but if any man offend not in word, the same as a perfect man, and also able to bridle a whole body. So I think that the remedy could be for the kids to, just like my brother was saying, to speak positive, to give them better speech, and for the cops. If the cops can come through and talk better to these kids, instead of approaching these kids on the bad side, approach these kids like they're young adults, like they, how you doing, sir? If they speech changed when they talk to each other, when they communicate with the youngsters, then everybody can get along better. Because now, by they looking and speaking to them like they're more young adults instead of hoodlums and thugs like I used to be treated, then maybe their body will change. They can bridle their body and be humble and speak to them with some respect instead of disrespecting them. Because the problem is with their mouth. They start off talking with disrespect, and then it turns into I'm an authority issue over you instead of a protector.
Got it. Thank you.
Millette had two young people, correct?
Okay. Yeah. And Monique, is it? Monique wants to say something.
My name is Monique. I'm in the ninth grade, and I just want to know why the police don't do nothing about it, like fights out of school and jump, stuff like that, period, because I got jumped, and they ain't do nothing.
Okay. So they were in the neighborhood?
I got jumped by a grown lady, her daughter and her son.
Okay, so the question was the police didn't respond, they didn't come to the scene?
They came, but they took the lady's side. I had a mark on my face and all that.
Okay. So, sweetheart, first of all, I'm sorry that happened. We should never, any incident where there's an adult fighting a child, and I wish I could say that's the first time I've heard that, but it's not. And so we got to do some work in the schools, working with parents, and I would need to know a little bit more specifics about what happened there. But the police should always respond, and you should know what the resolution is. So if you call the police, somebody should tell you what happened. And we'll fix that.
Do you know who you would call in that situation? I don't think our young people know what to do. If the police didn't do what she thought was the right thing, what's her recourse?
Well, there are a couple of things. And so I, as a ninth grader, I would tell the ninth grader to talk to the school counselor or principal. Also in the government, you can talk to your council member. You can talk to somebody in the mayor's office. And then there is an independent office called the Office of Police Complaints. Now, I'll tell you, what I know about this police chief is she doesn't tolerate officers that don't do the right thing. So the Office of Police Complaints is always a place to go. And anytime you don't know who to call in the government, you can dial 311. Tell them what your issue is, and they can connect you to the right government office.
Okay, we want to keep the conversation going on Twitter at hashtag IWishYouKnew. Remember, we're trying to hear from the young people today. So, of course, everyone likes to have their Twitter name shouted out. This is a tweet from @skinsforlife1975. He asked, what are you doing to keep kids occupied, especially at night?
Well, that's another great question. So, you know, we put in this government millions of dollars in recreation centers. And I tell this story, Joe, all across, because I bet you I can go to any one of our recreation centers in a block away or two blocks away, seeing a crowd of young people hanging out on the street. And then somebody will tell me, well, they don't have anything to do. And I say, well, what about that recreation center
that
two blocks down the street?
That $1 million recreation center.
No, that $30 million recreation center. And so what we have failed to do is figure out the programming that is going to attract young people inside instead of outside. So we're going to spend some time. I've tasked our team with developing what we call the Summer of Safety Strategies. When young people are out of school in the evenings, on weekends, to come up with more engaging programming. This year, for example, we're going to start, because what they're telling us, everybody has a phone, right? Raise your hand if you have a smartphone. Raise your green card if you have a smartphone. Okay, so what we're finding is that more and more interaction and learning is happening over these smartphones, and the jobs of the future are related to this technology. So this summer, we're going to start coding camps, for example, to teach young people how to code. We have 16,000 people, Jaron is here from the Department of Employment Service, that are signed up for a summer youth program. And so that's a period over the summer where you'll be working. And new this year, 1,000 young people ages 22 to 24 will also be signed up for summer jobs.
Really?
To keep them occupied. Yeah, that's brand new.
That's brand new.
Got a question over here.
Joe, you know, substance abuse is a big concern.
Yes,
as well. And this young man has something to say. Stand up.
First and foremost, I'd like to start off by saying thank you. My name is Dejon Cartier-Taylor, and and I was a freshman at American University. I also work with the Community Anti-Drug Coalition of America. And as a native of the greater metropolitan area, I truly believe that substance abuse prevention is something that we need to place emphasis on. Started abusing substances at the age of 13, and this will cause me to travel down the wrong path. And I believe that drugs truly do stimulate negative aspects of human potentiality, lest they limit our potential. And I believe that in order for us to be able to touch the youth that are in our area and help them come to the realization of who they are and what they are and what they're truly capable of, we need to truly make sure that their communities and, you know, their human psyche isn't being detrimented by drugs in our communities. And that's all I wanted to state. Thank you.
What's your name again?
Dijon Cartier Taylor.
Man, give him a round of applause. Potentiality.
We also we got another question over here.
Hey, Joe.
Yes.
Hey, Joe, that's awesome. Hey,
yes,
look,
Flavor.
I'm also from D.C., also MBYLI. Where you at? Everybody's Youth Leader Institute.
Yes.
Now, this young brother right here, we do have young people that are out working in the community right now. We have our youth outreach coordinators, D.C. Trust, where you at? Over here. Okay, these young people are under the age of 24 or under, okay? So they definitely fall in the youth category. And you had something you had to say.
What I want you to know, Muriel Bowser, is I'm a youth outreach coordinator in the Langston Carver community. And, yes, it's a lot that we need in the community over there in Langston Carver. We are standing out there 24-7, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. We don't have a rec center. But the government look at as Rosedale Recreation Center across Benner Road. And then on the back end, they look at Joe Coe's Recreation Center in Trinidad. Yeah. Now, clearly, 21st and East Street, 21st and Trinidad has been beefing for over a decade now. So 21st no longer have a rec center or never had a rec center. But what can you do to help my community better? What could you do to help to gain access to get us a rec center in that neighborhood? Because that's actually one of the high crime areas that really needs help. And I've been doing the grassroots work to help a lot of youth in the community. I'm even working on my own program to help these young men on the right path.
Well, I think one of the first things we could do is see if there what available space there is in the community. Because oftentimes, and we have that in other communities, in Woodland, for example, we bring in different nonprofits for in vacant units. So I would first want to start by figuring out if we have any available space where we can attract a nonprofit that's doing good work in the community that is going to engage residents. Maybe it's a program working with young mothers. Maybe it's a program around music and entertainment. But I would first start there, work and see if we can work with some available units to get programs in. But thank you for that suggestion.
Okay.
Man, way to go. Keep up the work, too, man.
Hey, Joe.
Keep up the work.
Corey's right here.
I got Andre Glosson right here. He has a question.
Question. It was about a new term that people are using is called food insecurity. And for many of us, you know, we waste food. Put too much on our plate, let it spoil, we waste it. But there are a lot of people in our community who don't know where their next meal is coming from. So there's a number of things that we're doing. All summer, when school is out, there are various locations in every ward where students can go and have a meal, just like they were in school. And so we'll make sure that that's clearly pointed out where the different nutrition sites are. They're usually at recreation centers. So families can go to recreation centers throughout the year. Another thing that I am funding in this budget is called Joyful Markets. Because what some families experience, they may be on public assistance and have food stamps, but by the end of the month, they've run out. And so they are either not buying healthy food or they're skipping meals altogether. So we are working to put Joyful Markets. We put in enough to get, I think, a jump start on all elementary schools in Ward 7 and 8. And so these schools will have these markets on the last Friday of the month so families every family in the school, so there's no, you don't have to show anything, can go and buy and get for free healthy food for their families. And so that's a very good thing. But thank you for thinking about those families. The last thing I'll say is this. We are also working with families who may or may not qualify in 60 months for the pretty meager benefits that they get in public assistance. So I've asked the council for these families, 6,000 families, 13,000 children, to continue that benefit beyond September 30th.
Thank you. Another issue that came up early on, Joe, when you asked, some people said they don't feel safe. Another concern in the audience is about gangs, and Skylar wanted to raise a point about that.
I'm in the ninth grade, and I wanted to know why the police respond late, like, on shootings and stuff, because recently, I just got shot at, and, like, when it was over, like, the police came all late, like, why do they respond so late?
You got shot at?
Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
So that's, you know, it sounds like a light description, but I'm sure it didn't feel that light at the time. And I've just, out of curiosity, you can raise your paddle if you want. Has anybody been a victim of violent crime here? Raise your green paddle. Okay. Oh. So a number of you have been a victim. Has anybody witnessed a violent crime here? Okay. So one thing that we've learned is that a lot of our students have experienced some trauma. It may be trauma in your house. It may be trauma that you've witnessed. There may be one of your family members that have been the victim of a serious crime. It may be one of your family members that have been a victim of a homicide. So we have a lot of young people dealing with trauma. So we want to make sure that their school staff and police staff and mental health staff that know how to approach a child that has experienced trauma. And to the question about when police respond, you would be surprised. I'm just going to tell you this. The number of people who see a crime happen and don't call the police. Because they assume what? Somebody else is going to call. So what I want everybody to know is if you see a crime happen, even if you think you see a crime happen, call the police. Don't assume that they already know. And that's how we can ensure a rapid response.
Madam Mayor, Skylar's mother wanted to say something on that point.
Well, I'm Skylar's mother, and when she told me of the incident of the people shooting at her, I was very distraught. My question is going to piggyback off her. I'm a Ward A resident. I've been a Ward A resident all my life, and I'm 46 years old and still don't feel safe in my neighborhood, and now I don't feel safe for my children walking home in my own neighborhood. What can we do to address that?
Well, we need to focus a lot of resources. So part of the theme that you'll hear us talking about today is it's not just police. The police have a role, right? But they're responding to something once it's happened. What can we do as a community to keep people from shooting at each other? So that's the question that we want to get to. And so part of our rapid response, there's also a proactive component. So we can target neighborhoods where we think there's prone to shooting and all of that, but we also need to get feedback from where the problems are so that we can work with a family that may have challenges. We can work with a person who we may think has a reason or has shown some evidence of being violent before the violence happens.
Let me shine some. I have a question for you guys. When I was growing up, we had this thing, don't be snitching. Don't snitch. Don't say nothing to the police. Even if you see something, man, don't be calling the police. That's still the norm. Don't snitch. Don't say anything if you see a crime.
Then you got to pose that question then. What if the crime is happening to them? They're going to want somebody to tell, right?
Pretty much.
Okay. Got a question
over here. Two-way street.
Now, we need to remember the importance of today is for you guys to voice your opinion. Not a lot of people our age, you know, are on the radio like everyone here. So don't be shy to raise your hand and let anyone around here know that you you have a question. But we still are trending on Twitter, so we're going to go to Twitter at Young Writer Ash. Ask, what are you doing to help homeless youth?
Okay, the question was about homelessness, and I think you all know that we have made a significant point of addressing homelessness in this city. My administration has made the commitment to end veteran homelessness this year. In family homelessness, we have a plan that will get us to be able to close DC General and end family homelessness by 2018. But it takes a lot of investment. It takes a lot of investment. And so we have a proposal down at the council now to invest $100 million in affordable housing. And we are hopeful that that will prevent families from becoming homeless in the first place. But the question was specifically about youth homelessness. And so there are a lot of youth who are living with their families in shelter. There's some youth on the street who are fending for themselves. There's some youth, a lot of youth, that are couch surfing. You know what that means? That means they're going from auntie's house to grandma's house to somebody else's house. But they don't have a place, a bed to call their own. When a youth has that type of housing insecurity, she can't study. She can't finish. She can't be hopeful about the future. So housing first is a serious, serious objective of our administration. We have put a youth homeless advocate on the body that's making all the decisions about where the money is spent around youth homelessness. And we have put a lot of resources around creating additional emergency shelter for youth as well. And there's more around child and family services that we'll get back to.
Thank you so much.
Flavor. All right. Young people. I love young people. I got Brother Corey right here. And he has a question on trust.
All right. So my name's Corey. I've been to go to Basis DC. I'm 15 years old. I am the son of a police officer, but at the same time, I'm an African-American teenager. And I struggle with the conflicting views of the coverage of police officers on TV shooting African-American teenagers. And so, specifically in the DC area, I was listening to the news a few years ago about how there were police officers involved in prostitution rings within D.C. And so my question is, how is it that the police officers expect us to trust them, but at the same time, we have them on the streets committing crimes?
That's an excellent question. So the question was about trust. Excellent question. So let me say, this is, and I think this is a good place, and did you say your name was Corey? Corey is the son of a police officer. And so this is what I want to say. The vast majority of our police officers go to work every day and do the right thing. They do. So we have a great police force. And just like any organization, there's some bad apples. Any organization you go to, you're going to find somebody that breaks the rules. And so our job is to make sure that our systems are good enough that we can catch those people. So we caught those bad cops. We dealt with those bad cops. And those bad cops were held accountable. And if we do that consistently, then the bad things that they did won't reflect on our entire force. But what you said is right. If we find a cop that does the wrong thing, they have to be held accountable. They're not above the law. And as long as I can look you in the eyes to say that, I know that we can continue to build that trust in the city.
We want to hear from a... You are youth mayor, correct?
Co-youth mayor.
Co-youth mayor. I'm sorry, co-youth mayor. This is Nyla Klusman.
Yes. Okay, yes. Hello, everyone.
Oh, everybody knows Nyla. Okay.
Okay, I'm Nyla Klusman. I'm with the Marion Barry's Youth Leadership Institute.
Yeah.
I'm co-youth mayor along with Ebony Johnson. And my main concern was unity with the youth. There's not enough unity in our community with our youth peers. And I want to know how we could get each other together, because there are events out there for our youth to come together and be involved with each other, get to know each other, and be unified, but they don't come. People don't participate. So how can we bring youth to programs and to events that get them together? I want to know from you guys how we could do that.
Great.
great question.
The mayor answered to ask the question. Who wants to answer?
Up top right there.
We have Anna Costa got a quick answer.
My name is Tajay, again. And I think the main way that you can reach out to younger people is social media, because everyone has a phone or tablet or laptop or has access to the internet, like a library or something. But social media would be the best way to get your programs out to people, because that's how I learned about the programs I'm in.
How did you learn about this one today?
School, because most programs come to all school, and it's a lot of programs in all school. But
okay, very good. Who else question wants to answer the mayor's question?
Right.
Hello.
Hello.
Okay.
I'm Abigail Hiller in the Mary and Barry's Youth Leadership Institute, and the answer to Nyla's question is a lot of you guys like food, right? If you just offer food, more people will come.
Food, okay.
But I also had something to say.
Have events around food. What, don't you guys like water?
I also had a question, not a question mostly, but like area problems. My brother a few months ago was like beat up by a gang. Well, not beat up. He was just like punched in the face or something. And then they like were trying to steal stuff from him, and like everything was closed. It was 11 o'clock at night, and it was like around Potomac Avenue, and that area is pretty bad. And once you get across the bridge, so I was just thinking that there could be like something for youth to do or something else for them to think about. Because me and my mom were like, what the youth need to put their frustration or their like time into something more productive than being in gangs and stuff.
I got it.
And there's That's food here after this event.
Oh,
too.
Good. Millette. Thank you, Millette.
Russell wanted to add on something, and then a young man had something to say about body cams, you were talking about.
Russell Gass for High Hopes. Basically, to answer her question, how we can help the youth engaged in the community right now, it's a big epidemic, and it's been for the last like 3 years as far as music, you know, everything dealing with performer arts, producing, modeling, visual arts. We need that incorporated in the summer youth programs and even in the schools. I know so many dudes on the street that, you know, yeah, they may be hustling, they may be committing crimes, but they spend most of their time trying to get in the studio, you know, trying to make music. So if you revolve everything around that and let that serve as a medium, then it can keep them out the streets, and that's less crime, you know, less police have to get into it with, you know, less black males and even youth, and that's more knowledge, and incorporate that with the mentors that teach them how to articulate their voice, you know, how to depersonalize themselves from situations that they shouldn't even be involved with, you know, when they're staying busy.
I got it. Music is an attractor.
I will say this, I produce as well, and I do know the power of being able to sit down and make something that's contemporary, that all the people like, and you made it with your own hands. You feel a certain kind of way. If you go in there with a rhyme and you get to get it out, you do feel a certain kind of way. You want to go back to the studio. But my question to you is, like, let's be real. How do we keep that gang element from overtaking? Because we know that's what usually how the studio for a month, it'd be cool to be the, you know, the Kendrick Lamar rapper come down, and then 2 months later, it'd be turned.
Let me give you an example. I changed all my music around to, you know, positive, and I have influence in the community. So, you know, I started working with this program, and now we have a couple of different sites in Ward 718. Let me give an example. In Brentwood, which I'm headed to right now, we have a group of females and dudes. They actually performed at the convention center about 3 weeks ago at the National War in Poverty, and they performed with artists they look up to, you know, known artists in the area. At first, they wasn't really engaging and coming to the program. After they performed, they got their songs together. Now they're coming there before me, you know, and they have a positive message, a positive song. Just the fact that they did something, you know, that nobody in their community did, and they had the courage to go up there in front of, you know, hundreds of people and perform, and it was positive, and they was giving a positive message, and now they're motivated to do that. if nobody's, you know, nobody like a key figure, like let's say Wale or, you know, Shag Lizzy, if nobody's promoting that, that's their idol in the community, you know, then why would they want to do it? And there's no really resources in the community to do it. How many studios, you know, community-based studio? I know one in Deanwood.
I know a lot of them. I'm behind you.
Oh, yes.
I know a lot of them because I work in the community. I work in Ward 7, not just on the radio. I'm with East River Family Strengthening Collaborative. There's a lot of people here. There's a number of them, especially with the D.C. Department of Recreation. Yeah. There's a number of community studios all around D.C. The thing is, like the young lady mentioned, some of us are being old heads, and we're staying on Facebook instead of on Snapchat and Instagram. So they do exist, but we do have to do some work to make that happen.
You two need to talk.
I'm just saying. Who on Facebook for real in here? Young people. All right. Yeah. Okay.
Y'all need to get back on Facebook.
So with that being said, there is a certain place where the marketing has to take place from the community organizations and from various government entities to reach. But without taking over or doing anything like that, I have this young lady from the Challenge Academy. All right. Sergeant First Class Patterson. Right. And she has a question in reference to troubled youth.
Hey. I'm representing the CAP regarding Youth Challenge Academy. I wanted to know where are the programs that help troubled youth? Like the ones in green, we were troubled youth, and we had a chance to have a second chance in life. School wasn't working for us. We got kicked out of school, drugs, different stuff, fighting, and it gave us a second chance in life. But where are more programs like that?
So Challenge Academy, and thank you for sharing that. And we recognize that we need more. I think that's the answer. And so we want to make our school so fantastic and engaging that everybody stays in school and graduates, gets their diploma, and goes on to work or to college. But we do recognize that that doesn't work for some kids and some families, and we have to make sure that we have a different approach. And we do that in some of our alternative high schools and in programs like Challenge Academy. So I know that we're going to work with our education team to make sure that we have more programs like that. The bottom line, if you're not able to finish for whatever reason, and there's a lot of reasons that come up in people's lives, that they aren't able to get through high school, that you're working towards the GED, working towards getting a good skill so you can get a good job. And that will continue to be our focus.
Okay, Madam Mayor, I have a question over here from Ronald. Statistics question. Stand up, Ronald.
Statistics? Uh-oh.
Hi, Madam Mayor. My name is Ronald Thompson. You came to Dunbar to introduce your
the
Audacity of Hope Challenge. And as a person who I've grown up here, so I saw all of this construction. I've seen my mother. My mother's from here. She grew up in Highland. My aunts, they grew up in Highland. All of my family has been from D.C. And I've watched the city evolve into something. But what I've also watched is this growing disparity between poor people, usually poor blacks, and upper class blacks leaving, going to Prince George's County, or white people who are able to afford these luxury apartments that are being built, or able to live in neighborhoods like Chevy Chase or Tinleytown, and they're able to go outside of their doors and go to dog parks and a playground across the street. And if you go a block over, there's another dog park and a playground across the street. But if you come to my neighborhood, and I've lived everywhere in Ward 8, I've lived on Southern Avenue, I've lived right down the street from Good Hope Road, I live in between Good Hope Road and Martin Luther King, and it's hard to find a recreation center. And when you do find it, there aren't activities, there isn't positivity, there are people doing things that are illegal. But at the same time, you know, while we can praise all the good stuff that you've done, why is it that people that work hard and go to school every day, their parents work hard and try to do the best for their children, they can't rise up, as you know, so many people say that we can. They can't afford the luxury apartments. They can't afford to own a home. So what is the city doing to not give people public benefits, but to give people the opportunity to own a home or to own one of these luxury apartments or to buy a new car or to make sure that their kids are going to school and that they have time to spend with their kids every day.
Well, thank you for that very...
Ronald.
Wasn't that good? So if you knew... See, this is what I know. When we ask young people what they think, they have some serious deep thoughts and great observations. In Ronald's question, you know, I ran for mayor for 2 years. So I spent a lot of time in Ward 8. And I was born and raised in Ward 5. I've lived in Ward 4 for the last almost 15 years. And so when I went into Ward 8, sometimes people would look at me and they would say, well, what do you know about us? You don't know anything about us. I don't know if I'm going to vote for you. And I would ask the next person, and they said, well, I don't know about you, Bowser, because this is what all politicians do. They come around at election time, and then we don't see them again. And then they said, well, I don't know if I'm going to even participate because nothing ever changes. And so I became very serious about making sure if I had the opportunity to be mayor, that something would change for Ward 8. Mm. And is it going to be overnight? No. But are we going to have leadership that wakes up every single day focused on making changes, big ones and small ones? Yes. That's why Courtney Snowden was appointed the deputy mayor. So we have to do some things. We have to make sure that we're raising incomes in Ward 8. And so we can start with people who have had trouble getting good paying jobs. And so we are making sure we're working with the young people, but also with people that need a second chance, to be honest with you. And so we started what we call the LEAP Academy, that's training people for jobs in DC government. So that's one way that we're doing it. Ronald raises another very good point. We want more people to be able to afford and be able to buy a home. That is one of the key steps in building wealth and building a pathway to the middle class. So that's why we're investing in affordable housing and first-time home buyer programs every single day. The way also to attract investment in Ward 8 is to make it safer and cleaner. So when you talk about parks and streetscapes and other amenities, those are investments that we've made all across the city. And we have dropped the ball. We haven't done enough in Ward 8. So what I can tell you is that there are big things that we can do, like ending homelessness, like providing job training. And there are small things that we can do every day, like cleaning the streets, making the streets safer, and putting in the types of amenities that other wards have seen for decades. So that's my commitment to Ward 8.
We have a question right here from a question from a young man named Reginald. Reginald wanted to ask his question.
Yes, sir.
As you said, my name is Reginald. I'm from Richard Wright Public Charter School for Journalism and Media Arts. And so, and you know, in my school, all we really do is try to connect to my people, like the people of my age, or even the adults through the ways of media, photography, and et cetera. And so, I don't mean to bring up old news, but I want to talk about the body cameras. And, like, I have a question about that, because if you just place the body camera right here on the chest, wouldn't it be also a possibility that they could, like, cover it up? But wouldn't it be, like, even safer if they had to, like, wear something mandatory, like, on their face or something, so that we can see what they see instead of what we're seeing right here?
Well, I think there's Richard? Okay, so I think the question was about body cameras and where the body cameras should be placed. So we have just finished a pilot, we're evaluating the evidence of the pilot, and the cameras were worn here. So to be honest with you, have to tell you and look into why it's not better to wear them here. Probably there's more compliance from the police officers if they're on their chest rather than if it's a headpiece. That's what my guess is. And so, as you know, the chest follows, you know, pretty much follows the direction that you're moving in. So you should be able to pick up what's being seen. Let me address something that's been a little controversial. In fact, the police chief is down at the council testifying about it now. And that's because when you have a new technology like body cameras, you're learning a lot as you go along. And so our focus is for accountability. We want every officer to know that every interaction that they have is being filmed. But we also want to protect your privacy. And so what I have told the council is we have to do these body cameras, but I can't put every interaction with a police officer on the evening news. Okay, I can't do that. So imagine this. So imagine, you know, I'll use myself as an example. Let's say, you know, I get into a fight with somebody and I got to call the police to my house. Or let's say somebody's beating me up in my house and I got to call the police. I don't want that on the evening news. And I don't want you to be scared to call the police when you need the police. So what our body-worn camera program will do is that anybody involved in that incident will be able to get access to it. The U.S. attorney will be able to get access to it. And let me acknowledge Ms. Wendy, is it Pohlhouse, who's here representing the U.S. attorney, Vincent Cohn, and thank you for being here. The attorney general will be able to get it. The Office of Police Complaints will be able to get access to it. The public defender will be able to get access to it. The D.C. auditor will be able to get access to it. So a lot of people will be able to view the video, but it would not go up on the evening news, okay? So I just want to be clear what our policy will be around cameras. And I can assure you this, we're going to put it, we're going to place it on the officer where it makes the most sense.
All right, let's go to Brittany.
Not only are we trending on Twitter, but we're also accepting questions via text message. And it's interesting that you mentioned the snitches get stitches because it ties in right with this. So we will definitely want to kill that. This question is there better protection for people and families that want to be witnesses?
Wendy, you want to answer this? Let's get a microphone for Wendy.
My name is Wendy Pohlhouse, and I'm a prosecutor. And all of you all know what a prosecutor is? All right, so in my office, what happens is that when you're a witness, our office and the Metropolitan Police Department takes great aims to protect witnesses. And what happens is that there's different types of programs. Most people were able to keep safe. We immediately move you out the neighborhood. We move you out what we call the zone of danger. And usually that means going to another neighborhood, maybe uptown or maybe in Virginia, or if you have family members who live in another state, will pay for you to go to the other state. So most people are moved out of the zone of danger immediately, and we're able to keep most witnesses safe. It's a misnomer. It's not true that snitches get stitches, because we move most people who are witnesses from the zone of danger. In very rare occasion, and we will actually put you in the witness protection program, but that is very rare. And so witnesses do not get hurt. The only time there's issues, if we move you out of the zone of danger, sometimes witnesses won't listen and won't follow the rules, and they'll go right back to where we told them not to go, and that's a problem. But this whole issue about snitches got stitches, I think we as a community kind of have to change the dialogue, right? So the dialogue has to be, do we care about children? And when I talk about people, I always say that it's unacceptable that we allow our children to lie in the street shot and everybody pretend like didn't see it, right? Mm-hmm. So we need to begin to change the dialogue to where we begin to stand up for each other. And if we're really going to say all lives matters, our life matter, it matters no matter what. And so we have to say as a community, that's not going to be okay to be lying in the street and no one saw anything.
Now, is there a website that they can all put out there, you know, since we love Twitter and Instagram so much, where they can find you?
Yes, they can go to the United States Attorney's Office, usaodc.gov, and there'll be a witness protection. We have a whole witness protection unit that not only do we provide protection, sometimes what we do is we put new alarms on your house, we put cameras on your house, and we also provide counseling and other victim support. So victims get a lot of support because we protect our victims, and our victims are not, they're heroes, so we treat them as such.
So let's change that quote to snitches save lives.
Amen.
How about that?
Can we do that?
That's right.
Snitches save lives. I think a brother right behind you has a question, Brittany.
We had a question behind
when I listened. When I was listening to all the comments from around the people, I kind of came to the realization that if we actually want to change things in D.C. and change, basically our race as a whole, we have to start with the media. And I heard a lot of stuff about what the brother over there was saying about how music can heal and comfort and how it can bring the community together. But a lot of times what I'm hearing is that it's actually oppressing us as a people. It's actually making us worse. When I turn on the radio, I hear drugs, sex, you know, alcohol, drugs, sex, alcohol. And then we get kind of surprised when it translates into the things that we see in D.C. And I know, you know, money comes from it, and I feel like individuals focus on themselves getting to a higher state. But like, I truly believe if we change the way that we are perceived on television, if we change the way that we are perceived in, you know, the music industry, then that would actually have an effect on our mental, you know, where we feel we are as a people. And as long as we continue to let it influence us like that, then we'll continue to be in the places that we are right now.
Thank you.
Good one. Great comment. Speaking from someone who's in the media and who has to play the records you're talking about, I understand exactly where you're coming from. The challenge is to get young people to actually activate that other way of thinking. Like, you know, if there's going to be a show one night and it's going to be Fetty Wap versus seeing somebody who's talking something positive, you already know where everybody's going to go. Now, you may go to the good show, but you know everybody else want to go, let's turn up as soon as you get out of here. And there's people that's sitting right here, right now. And I was a college student. I was going to school. I was doing my thing. But as soon as class was over, let's turn up. So there has to be, and I hate to put the burden on your generation. Your generation is actually going to have to step up bigger, because what you're asking for is a change for you. My boss won't listen unless you make him change. You understand what I'm saying? Unless more than one of you say, I need to hear better music. I need to hear something more uplifting. I need a better artist. If nobody's really willing to take that stand, you know, we're going to get what makes money.
And to piggyback off what he just said, people under 25, like I'm under 25 and work in radio, I realize y'all run what we play. You guys are, basically most of our stations are demo, so we do want to play what you guys want to hear. You can definitely turn up in a positive way. I promise you, it's possible.
Yes, it is.
Hello, I am a poet from the Joe Claire Morning Show. I have Jalen here from DC Prep, and he had a question for our wonderful mayor.
Hi, my name is Jalen, and my question is, how can you stop schools from pushing kids out of kicking kids out of school? Because when they kick the kid out, the kids are like losing interest of school and start to go on the streets and acting real bad and start to join gangs and stuff.
Excellent question. Thank you.
Great question. Great question, young man.
So this young man wishes we knew the impact it has when kids are suspended or kicked out of school altogether, right? That's what you wish we know. And I'm going to kick it to the Deputy Mayor for Education, because she knows a lot about what we need to do to change that dynamic. So if a young person is not behaving well in school and is being disruptive to other kids, we do recognize that we need a different situation for that young person. But what's the best way to deal with it? Jenny?
Well, one thing is I just have to shout out Jalen, because I've known him since he was a little boy. Uh-oh. And so he is as smart as you just saw him be. Yay, you know, we have to have schools that kids want to come to. So we need to have it be a place that everybody wants to be. And then we need to have understanding adults, and we need to have a situation that supports students when they walk in the door and if they haven't had breakfast or they walk in the door and haven't had a good day so far. So we need a lot of work around the schools piece. Then we need to, when a student does something wrong, we've got to engage that student in understanding why. And so it's one thing to have the student not be in school. If they're not safe, that's the only reason that I can understand about why a student shouldn't be in school, because they're not safe to the other students. But we still need to figure out with the student who has been asked to step out of school for a while to serve them, because they're acting out because something's not right. Something in their life is not happening for them, because everybody wants to learn. And so we need to create the situation for that to happen. And so to Jalen's point, we want to minimize, if not take away, the what I would call an exclusionary event, having kids have to miss school because of something that happens. We need to solve it in a different way so that we are not missing learning time.
Good afternoon,
Mayor, and good afternoon. I just wanted to say that we need more leaders in the youth, because a lot of people say they're going to do things and change it, but when they get home, they don't do it. And they just fall under the peer pressure from their friends, because they be like, oh, my friend smokes, so I'm going to do it too, and they're just scared. So we need more leaders in the community, young leaders, to do something about this stuff.
Excellent point. Now we have a great question from Twitter, since we were just talking about the importance of education. And we know, even though we're in a library, I'm still going to say this, we rely a lot on the internet for our education. So this question says, what are the current administration plans in regards to free Wi-Fi and for lower income communities? Because, you know, students need that. And that's from at the Prissy.
Well, I'm glad you asked me that. This may be the first time that I'm telling anybody, but our Department of Parks and Recreation has a plan to have free Wi-Fi in all of our parks and recreation facilities.
Yay.
All right.
So now I said it. You heard me say it, Jenny. So now it definitely has to happen. But it's a good thing that you asked me about the library, because some of you think that the library is just for books, right?
No, they come for the
internet. And there's nothing wrong with books. But there's a lot that happens in this library, including there's a 3D printer and maker facility that they have in this library. And we're also going to transform this library over the next 3 years. So it'll be a place for books. It'll be a place for workforce development. Our library director is just there. Hi, Rich. Wave your hand to Rich. And the Martin Luther King Library, our central library. So no matter where you live, this is your library. And a lot of great things will continue to happen here. Let me, before we go, I want to make sure we have the opportunity to acknowledge Reverend Tony Lee, who's here, and see what input he has for the young people.
You have to excuse me. I was enjoying the conversation so much. So I really don't want to take away a minute of what these great young people are saying, because really, this is you all's forum. Y'all can hear a preacher anytime, but I really want to hear them. If you don't mind, Madam Mayor, but I'm really blessed to hear them.
I'm glad you're here.
No, that's fine.
Okay, we have a young lady here.
Oh, right behind us.
Hello, my name is Omalara Williams McAllister, and I just aged out of your youth category, but have been working as a provider of services for youth for the last 6 years in DC. And my question goes about people who work with youth. So my experience has been that many of my coworkers who are not youth are unaware of the services that are available to youth, and or are uninterested in referring their youth to other people's programs to get supportive services in other areas. And so my question to you is, what are you doing to make sure that people providing services to youth are aware of all of the programs that you're mentioning and are still held accountable to doing their work in terms of making sure that youth are connected to those different resources?
That's an excellent question. And so I know that our Children's Youth Investment Trust is represented here. I think I saw Ed Davies a little bit earlier. And you may know that most of our youth programming funds in the district go through the Youth Investment Trust. And for too long, we send money to this program or this nonprofit, and we don't hold them accountable for results. And the trust, over the last several years, has been very helpful in holding those providers accountable. And also training providers, so that we know that the people providing these services have the best training and knowledge of services available.
And we as youth need to take responsibility too. I mean, you can't say, oh, I didn't know about things if you didn't look for them. We can use Google. Yes. We have another question right here for you, Mayor.
Right. How you doing, Madam Mayor? I'm sorry. My name is Shaka Williams, and I also go to Rich Wright Public Charter School for Journalism and Media Arts. So my question is, first of all, does anybody know their basic rights when talking to a police officer? Just anybody? Yes, please use it. Do y'all know y'all basic rights?
Use your green
And your red.
Green and red. Everybody? Okay. So my thing is, yes, we're educated about it. Not everybody on the street is. So I want to know, and that's just not just for police rights. It's kids out here, well, youth. It's the youth out here that, you know, yeah, they slipped up and had a baby. Or, you know, the food thing. the services is not being offered inside the schools, especially not in my school. And I'm not saying that my principal's doing a bad job, because he's not. He's doing an excellent job as far as education reform and everything else. But as far as the public schools, there's nothing about nurturing. You know, as far as sex ed is not really a popular thing anymore, except it's in middle school. But as far as high school, who really knows on, you know, the sexual stuff that's going on, the diseases? Nobody really knows about that stuff. So my thing is, can you offer or can you reiterate, you know, the things, or can you put back into the schedules sex ed, or, you know, how to take care of a baby? Because when you pop it out, it's just there. Like, you know, little Nene just out there now. There's nothing he can do except collect the wick. We need these classes back. So we need that.
Got it. Thanks for that feedback. Right. So more sex, you were talking my language when it comes to sex ed, and your points about parenting and parenting classes are also noted for the deputy mayor.
We have a
mayor,
question.
Mayor Bowser, I wanted to address the one thing he asked about youth rights. East River Family Strengthening Collaborative, Columbia Heights Collaborative, a number of organizations are partnered with the U.S. Attorney's Office for our youth summit that we do every year at Friendship, and everyone here is invited to come absolutely free, and it's about youth knowing their rights. This year we focus specifically on knowing your rights. We have food there, and it's taking place at Friendship June 26th. So if you want to know about new youth rights, we have it for you.
All right. We'll definitely get that word out.
I want to give
yes.
Brandon Wilson here has been dying to ask a question. I want to make sure he gets an opportunity to do so.
Actually, it's a comment. I'm Brandon Wilson, I'm 24 years old. I'm with the Hope Project, helping other people excel. So this project with the graduates making $42,000 a year without a college degree. They're teaching IT. We are so proficient in teaching these young folks IT, it's crazy. Like, look at me. What I look like? I just came home from jail, and these hopes are helping me. I don't care if I'm saying on the rail, because I got to say it on job application anyway, you know? So then I want to help with DYRS, because I want to teach these young folks. For one, it starts with the role models. You know, they get in the media and all that, but then it's role models, these young people in the streets that's actually doing this stuff that they saying, and then these people are looking up. I mean, these young people are looking up to them. You know, so I want to go to Oak Hill. I've been to Oak Hill. I've been committed to DYRS. I want to go to YIC. I want to talk to these young people. Me and my team can help these young people. That's all I want. That's all I want to say. Thank you.
Yeah, and before we skip out of here, you want role models. There's plenty of people in here. So you can feel free to go up to myself and anyone else you see standing around here, including the mayor. She's right here. Let them be your role model.
Got it. So we want to, before we close out, Joe, turn to the deputy mayor for greater economic opportunity. And she is going to give us some final thoughts.
So you know what I wish you knew? Just how proud we are of you. You guys have done such a fantastic job and during this conversation. I want to ask you to give the mayor and Joe Claire a round of applause for the great conversation they led today.
That all for the mayor.
Now, this conversation doesn't end right here. We want you to stay on social media, on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, which only the mayor and I apparently on. And we want you to tell us and get your friends to tell us what they wish we knew about them. The other thing we want you to do is really take heed to what was said today, which is we all play a role in solving the problems of our community. So when you go home, I want you to give a lot of thought to what you heard here today. But more importantly, I want you to think about how you can contribute to improving your community very locally in your neighborhood and your community of the city of Washington, D.C. All of us are incredibly proud of you. We want to see you continue to do the great things that you're doing. And this is just the first step in what will be a very long conversation in the Bowser administration. Thank you.
You, everybody. So let
Come
me
on, let's give it up
close.
For our mayor. Let's give it up for our mayor.
Thank you, Joe.
Come on.
Thank you, guys.
She did not have to be here today. She came out for you guys. I think we owe her a big round of applause.
Thank you. But let's give it up for Joe Claire and the fact that all of our radio stations came out, WPGC,
yes.
WKYS,
yes.
WHUR,
oh, yeah.
Magic 102,
uh-huh.
And El Zol,
yes
so
it did.
So you'll hear this conversation on all of those stations over the next several days, and I wish you knew
how far we can go with you. God bless you, everybody.
And we have pizza.
Oh, and there's pizza.
Don't forget, pizza is
here. One last question. Was this good today? Was this good today? Very good. Pizza donated by Lito's. Lito's pizza. When you think pizza, think Lito's pizza. How you doing, man?
Make sure you tell her right now.